Welcome to The Radical CEO, transformation stories from the C-suite, with your host, Libby Gill. Libby started her career in Hollywood, where she led communications at media giants Sony, Universal, and Turner Broadcasting. Now, as a human engineering expert, she leads leadership, coaching, and consulting firm Libby Gill & Company, where she guides Fortune 500 clients to lead through change, challenge, and chaos. An international speaker and award-winning author, Libby's mission with this video cast is to bring you intimate conversations with business and thought leaders who've transformed careers and companies with their radical ideas and bold actions.
Welcome, everyone. I'm really excited about this episode of The Radical CEO because I have a passion for millennials, like today's guest. First of all, I've got two of my own, but also, and I sort of hesitate to generalize because millennials have gotten so unfairly stereotyped, I think. But what I will say that what I see in my work as a leadership coach and consultant is that millennials often see the world through completely fresh eyes compared to some of their older counterparts. And I really appreciate that. That is so true of my guest today. Akshay Maliwal is the founder and CEO of the very aptly named DreamBig.Events, a sports event company. It's dedicated to creating tournament and exposure opportunities for junior athletes across Asia, so far anyway. But that was just the beginning. When Akshay saw that young athletes and their families were interested in opportunities to play college sports in the U.S., he created a touring program to introduce golfers, swimmers, tennis players, the list of sports he covers goes on and on, to U.S. campuses that would be the best fit for their sports. And now, having gotten more than 500 student athletes college bound, he is on his way to building what he hopes will become the world's leading sports management firm. But despite that groundbreaking idea and a really auspicious start, Akshay admits that being a millennial founder and CEO of a company has not always been easy. In an article he wrote for LinkedIn, which I love, called "I'm Not 29, I'm 21 with 8 years of experience," he laid out the good news and also the challenges of being a young entrepreneur, which he's going to share with us today. So welcome, Akshay Maliwal.
Thanks, Libby. Really appreciate being here. It's been a fantastic career that I've had so far with DreamBig.Events. I'm excited for the future.
Well, tell me where your sports start. Were you a child athlete? Where did you begin?
Yeah, so my journey actually started as a recruited student athlete to UC Berkeley, Cal. Well, I played college golf there, and I was recruited straight out of Asia. It was the first time a kid was really getting heavily recruited into the Pac-12, which is, you know, tends to be a very competitive conference. So Asian golfers have previously never got those type of opportunities. I was fortunate to be a great golfer when I was in the junior system in Asia. So I think that gave me the platform to kickstart my college career. But I never really thought that I would actually get a scholarship or I would get recruited to go and play golf at a prestigious U.S. college.
Yeah, one of the best colleges in the country.
Fortunately, I mean, I think one of the biggest criteria for my family was the brand or the academic branding of the college. And some of the things that we tell our clients today is that they're going to spend that kind of money to send their kids to the U.S. They better be ready to, you know, pick and choose the right fit college.
And that's where you guide them, right?
Absolutely.
So tell me about the business today, how you rep those student athletes and then how that grew into your college touring.
Absolutely. So we started 4 years ago and we started with the mission of why don't we give more exposure to student athletes in Asia? And one of the challenges that student athletes in Asia have is that the proximity is so far from U.S. colleges. So bringing U.S. college coaches to recruit talent in Asia was basically a fraction of the cost, but also a great opportunity for these kids to get recruited at their home ground. So I was excited to actually get college coaches for the first time ever to US, to Asian countries, have Asian kids have an evaluation opportunity, those Asian kids may not have the means or the affordance to travel all the way to the US, because the same camp would cost them 5 to 6 times more if they did it in the US. And so at a fraction of the cost, you get the same recruitment opportunity as any other American kid. So that was the initial motive.
And where, did you just wake up one day and say, I need to start a sports management company, or was it based on your own recruiting experience?
I think it was really based on my own recruiting experience, because when I went to the US for college, there was nobody in Asia that actually helped to guide me through the athletic process. And I really had no points of exposure, experiences with these coaches before I got recruited. So I almost feel like my recruiting process was so tedious. It took a lot longer. And for me to get connected to these coaches was a lot more cumbersome, for lack of a better word.
Yeah.
I think the change that Dream Big Events has made for families in today's, you know, day is that now families can come to one of our events. They get that immediate or impactful experience. Once they get that immediate experience, they can go away and know, is this college a fit for my son or daughter? Is this college something that I would like to pursue? And if so, this is a good start to building a relationship with that college. And so we've done that for golf, tennis, soccer, swimming, and we're continuing to do events. We've done more than 25 events in the last 3 years. And you asked me, where did this whole touring experience come from?
Right.
It came from the desire that some of these families said, okay, hang on a second. Now I've experienced colleges in Asia, college coaches coming to Asia. It's time for me to maybe use some of my savings and take that next step and go and travel to the US and have that same experience. So initially there was a lot of hesitation around participating in a tour. It's more expensive. There's no clarity on whether they will get a scholarship. But that first step of attending a camp in Asia gave them that kind of motivation to be part of a tour shortly after, which they are able to now spend on because they have that value understanding.
So are you essentially recruiting these athletes? Are they finding you? Is it a little bit of both?
Absolutely. So we have a very large-scale referral program set up in Asia. Most of the local coaches on the ground that, you know, coach at a country club, coach an academy, they are identified by our team of consultants. That team is then putting them on an advisory or a referral program. So anytime they have a kid between 12 and 18 years old that senses that, you know, this is a college-bound student athlete, they will recommend that student to us. So in Asia, which is a very high-touch society, you don't have a lot of online marketing that works successfully. You need to spend a lot of time in building your relationships, because this is still a relationship-driven society. Mm-hmm. People don't make decisions based on something they read online. They make decisions based on a reference they receive or word-of-mouth interest they receive.
And the camps allow you to establish some of those relationships with the parents and the students?
Yeah, and the way I describe it is that camps are bite-sized experiences, right? So it's very easy for a family to come and experience a camp and then have an immediate outcome. I think the challenge with other types of consulting programs or college placement that ends up being a longer gestation. So families don't know the outcome until they either get placed into college or until they have a, you know, the experience is just that much longer. But with a camp or with an event that we run, it's 2 to 3 days long. The kids get an immediate experience and the parents get an evaluation report. That evaluation report by the coaches tells them this is the direction your kid should head.
And do you tell them if you think somebody's not going to cut it or not make it? Do you let them know they should maybe not spend their money trying to get into one of the top tier US schools?
Absolutely. And I think it's very important to be extremely transparent.
Yeah.
One of the things that we pride ourselves in doing is we decipher between those who have the potential and those who should probably just apply to the same colleges, but through the regular academic route. So, and if they were to consider the regular academic route, we have partner companies like Added Sport that provide those placement services opportunities. And so we would recommend them to that sort of company. So we are very clear and very focused that if a student athlete is someone who really shows potential to be, you know, in one of the leading athletic and academic colleges, we will push for them to make that happen. But if a student athlete is not necessarily there yet, or maybe their maturity level in terms of understanding their own athletic level is not there, we will tell the parents that. And even the college coaches who evaluate them will give that feedback.
So this, it reminds me a little bit of Jerry Maguire, the movie where he was good in the room. I always love that line. He's good in the room. They send him in to talk to the athletes and their parents. Is there some of that involved?
I think at some level, everybody who's in sport wants to be a sports agent. I think being a sports agent is probably the epitome or the dream for every person. I think the challenge with being a sports agent that I identified 7 years ago was that it's a crowded market. There's a lot of agents in the market moving, circling around these kids. I think one of the things that I've built pride in is that we have developed a strong bond or relationship with families from a junior level. And so those families have that intangible trust with us. And we don't want to break that trust by saying, okay, now we're going to commercialize your child. The other reality is that less than 0.01% of athletes actually become professional. So if I have a large scale grooming program where I'm setting up all these events, camps, tours, and eventually funneling them into US colleges, and then after college, some are turning professional, I'm at ground zero. I'm identifying those kids at ground zero, and that intangible goodwill that I've built with these families will hopefully count for something if I do decide to become a Jerry Maguire sometime in the future. But I think at some level, every young entrepreneur in sports management is aspiring to be a Jerry Maguire, and I am no different.
Okay. All right. So now, how many people do you have now, and what's it like being a new leader managing? You're a millennial managing, I assume, other millennials.
Absolutely. And I think it's important for me to tell you guys right now that this is my second company started. So, you know, I have employees that have worked for me in the past and other in another company, but in this company now, we're approaching 15 people, and we're running multiple events across Asia, India, Southeast Asia. There's about 20 events we're doing per year right now. So I think one of the biggest challenges that I face is just when you're running events, it's always crunch time during events. And you can plan as much as you can plan. But during events, something or the other always goes wrong. And I'll give you a perfect example. For the first three tennis camps we ran, it rained in every single camp. And there was no access to indoor facilities. And then the fourth camp, the college coaches got stuck in New York because of a snowstorm. So they arrived 24 hours late. So the point I'm trying to make is that you have to expect the unexpected continuously. And so contingency planning is the most critical part of event planning.
So you've learned now, I assume, what to do when there's a downpour and we've got to do something with these young athletes that have come to your camp.
Yeah, I mean, in the beginning, it was absolute bootstrap. You know, we're like, you see every event planner that works for me running around helter-skelter, trying to figure out how to pacify families who are erupting because they've paid and, you know, it's raining and this and that. But the great thing is that if you have a great plan, and if the mission is clear that you want to help the kid get exposure, network with those coaches, then no matter how bad the weather is, the kids and the coaches will make a point to connect. And so we spent a lot of that, like that was our core mission. And so we identified, you know, if this is our core mission to connect the parent, the student with the college coach, then rain or shine, that can still take place. Now, the tennis court evaluation is important. And so when it stopped raining, we quickly dried the courts and, you know, we get back on. But if the mission or the core value of the event is transparent and told to everyone, then whether you meet the coach, you do fitness with the coach indoor, or you play on the court, it shouldn't change the experience of the event. So we figured that out through a lot of unfortunate circumstances.
Yeah, I bet. But what you're talking about is building trust over time and being open and honest about the experience, I assume, including some of the glitches that you've experienced and had to come back from.
Absolutely. And I think this is something that a lot of other entrepreneurs can learn from, is that it's okay to tell someone that you are a small company. It's okay to tell someone that you're not experienced. Because if you show commitment to the event, or if you show commitment to the work ethic, if you show commitment to actually doing it, people will appreciate that. So we ran our first ever golf event last week. People knew that from the first moment I ran it. And at the end of the event, people said, this is the most amazing event I've ever been to. And these kids have been to plenty of golf tournaments. They've been to plenty of golf events. So for people to go away saying after the first event, they're skeptical, but they took a chance on us, and then the experience was so high, that trust is automatically built. But if you tell someone that, you know, I'm a serial experienced event operator, I've had millions of events, but people then find out that this is really your first golf event and, you know, you're a bit scrappy, you lose a lot of trust. So what I will tell entrepreneurs is that if you're doing something for the first time and somebody is maybe, you know, the first mover or the first client or the, you know, the first person you're consulting, don't be afraid to tell them that this is my first time doing this with you. Take a chance on me. You have to plead a little bit. You have to convince them a bit. Take a chance on me. Show them that your work ethic is really something to be inspired. And then watch as momentum carries you.
And I would expect they would feel a little invested in you and the company. They're taking a chance on you. They're helping you build as well.
Yeah, I mean, in Asia, there's a saying that, you know, you don't want to be the first piggy, right? Which is, you don't want to be slayed the first, right? And so I think that is very much ingrained in most Asian families. As I mentioned to you earlier, it's all about reference checks. It's all about what is the credibility of this company. So it really did help, though, that we were already doing tennis camps and soccer camps and other camp. So that credibility brought us to the point of sale for golf events. But we had no experience in golf events. Now, obviously, we have one level of experience. So having to convince the customer that is really a hard-nosed thing. And you have to be quite vulnerable in that experience. Because
I imagine you get a little rejection along the way.
Oh, yeah. I would say that we probably we had 32 kids participate in our golf event. And we probably prospected 400 kids. The numbers are always against you.
Right.
I think it's the persistence and the continuity of just like finding ways to make it work that really matter. The other thing in events that I want to mention is that you have to be quite nimble. And what I mean by nimble is you have to be quite flexible about how you make, you know, discounting, how you call something an early bird, how you give someone a repeat, you know, repeat rate, all these things. That nimbleness has to be high. Because if you can't really provide a customer additional value for them being a repeat customer or for them continuing on the journey with you, then they will feel like, I was that first mover for them. Right. Why am I not getting the second opportunity at a better rate?
Right.
Yeah, so there has to be some nimbleness around the price, around the value. And maybe if you don't change the price, then you give them more values. For example, some of our clients who've been in other events, we gave them an opportunity to have a one-on-one with the college coaches that was exclusive to them because we thanked them for being in our first event. So, you know, these sort of things make the experience a lot more valuable, I would say. Right. And you have a higher retention rate.
So we're talking to Akshay Maliwal. He is a millennial entrepreneur and founder of Dream Big Events. So Akshay, I imagine in this process of growing your company, you had to do some growing personally.
Absolutely.
What was the biggest change in yourself in order to get this company off the ground and continuing to move forward? Doesn't sound that easy the way you're describing it. It takes a lot of work.
Yeah, I think, and you know, I mentioned in this earlier segment here, I said being vulnerable is very important. I think for me, the biggest challenge was my attention to detail is quite high. And so that ends up being on the extreme side where I tend to have like a micromanagement view of things. And if you're a manager and if you're trying to lead a team, and you know, that's what I've been trying to do for the last 4 or 5 years with events, you have to let people do their thing, but making sure that they know the goals and they know the vision and their KPIs are clearly set. I think for me, the biggest challenge was actually motivating people, but not getting in their way. And initially in the beginning, I was getting in the way of a lot of my employees or colleagues, and it would stop them from doing a lot of stuff because they would have to spend a lot of their time giving me updates as opposed to actually doing the work.
Doing the work, right.
Yeah, so one of my biggest realizations, and this is a challenge I think all entrepreneurs who are under 30 will face, is that you tend to want to have perfection. Mm-hmm. And the way I describe it is 50% of your effort that somebody else does is better than you giving your time to do that. Mm-hmm. So being perfect is not the goal here. The goal here is to be able to scale up the business and have people do their job. And even if they don't do the job to the 100% level that you can do it, mm-hmm. you don't have time to do that. So the 50% they do it is better than the zero that you are going to give to them. So
that is,
my mindset had to change.
Right. So you had to learn to let go, which is anxiety producing. I've seen a lot of, particularly younger leaders, there's this sort of tipping point where they realize if they don't let go, they can't move up. They can't scale and they can't be more strategic until they let go. And there's this it's like the trapeze artist where, you know, you got to let go before you can catch on to the next one. And you're kind of hanging there in midair for a while before you learn to trust others with the work.
Yeah, I mean, the way I look at this is that if you have good people, and remember, good people is not defined by somebody just coming in and being good. Good people is defined by they have innate ability, but they need to be trained.
Yep.
Like, I used to think that just hiring good people was the way to have a good person on your team. But people don't know coming in what is your motive. They don't know what your goals are. They don't know how to align their skill set with your goal. And so my whole mission now is to work on training, is to work on training through management, and then is to set clear KPIs, clear goals for my colleagues, so that there are periodic checks and everybody does receive feedback, but they also don't get it continuously. So there is a fine line, or there's a dotted line in the sand between continuous feedback and periodic feedback.
Right.
And you need to find the balance.
I think you have to customize it for the individual and the situation. But just for anybody that doesn't use KPI as part of their vocabulary, explain what that is.
Yeah. So I think KPIs mean key performance indicators. Yeah. It's basically a way for you to measure the performance of any colleague, any employee. It's a way for you to set goals. So another version of KPI is goals, right? So you would want to set 3 to 6 to 9 to 12 month goals. Usually annual performance reviews take place in companies. So setting an annual goal is great, but I think you need to bring it up a little bit more short term because annual goals are a little bit too lofty, especially for new hires. Mm-hmm. They don't know the vision, the mission of the company yet. So you need to work closely with them and set up 3 month goals and then 6 month goals and then maybe 12. So usually what I do is I do a 3 month goal check, I do a 6 month goal check, and then I do an annual goal check. And we build it up towards that annual performance review. So I think it's very important to do that, but that has to happen after training has taken place.
Right.
Because without training, goals mean nothing. Because someone cannot perform their best for the role that you have given. And I learned the hard way. I hired a lot of people that were sitting on the wrong seat. And that's something that you learn through trial and error. And again, I'll say, don't be scared if people are on the wrong seat. That's part of me learning, and that's part of the process that I faced. And, you know, I'll be honest with you. In the beginning, I was a terrible recruiter. Mm-hmm. I was identifying all these people for wrong fillings in our company. And through trial and error, through a lot of mistakes, I realized that this is the type of person I'm looking for in this job. This is the type of person I'm looking for in this job. So I was using experience of candidates mm-hmm. as a way to identify them for a position. But I needed to use their skill set and knowledge base. And that can translate into many different applications.
And I think also just their potential for growth, because you certainly in a new company, people were not going to come in with that exact experience because it's very limited out there. It's an original idea. So being able to identify great people, and as you said, put them in the right spots, train them towards the future, and then let them flow through the company as they grow. I think that is the way companies are evolving today.
Yeah, and you know, by no means am I an expert at this so far, but like, I do know that this is the biggest challenge that I face, and because a lot of the time, you know, work ethic, ability to have a great idea, all of those things seem to bog down entrepreneurs. I'll tell you one thing, no idea is a bad idea. Good ideas happen because the people you put there to help you grow the business.
I think you start with your best bad idea.
Exactly. It's nothing to do. Exactly. It's nothing to do with how clever your idea is. Right. It's everything to do with who are the people you put in place to help you build that idea. Because everybody who's coming in as a first employee into a startup, they know this is a startup. They know that this is the commitment required to be in a startup. Mm-hmm. And if they don't know, that better be part of the interview process that you are telling them, right? So these are some of the trade-offs and challenges that I face just from a personal standpoint as I've grown DreamBig.Events.
So as you're looking at other millennials, whether they want to be entrepreneurs or intrapreneurs inside of organizations, and millennials have gotten a bad rap and not deserved, certainly everything you're talking about, there's no slacker, there's no, you know, any of that in there. What do you think about the myths and the misconceptions and what you see?
I think there's a big misconception that millennials turn over jobs very quickly. Millennials tend to have a 9-to-3 attitude. They don't want to work after 3 p.m. They tend to want big salaries and do little work. I think there's a lot of misconceptions around that.
Yeah, I do too.
And I think the biggest misconception there would just be that they're not committed. I mean, the commitment doesn't always have to be in sitting there on the desk for 15 hours a day. I think that is a very traditional way of thinking.
Right.
That was there in the investment banking world, in the consulting world, in the world that if I'm going to hire a young out of college person, his whole demeanor and attitude towards this company needs to be just sitting on the desk and slaving away. Mm-hmm. I think the world is changing because I think with technology, I think a lot of people now can work remotely. That's one. I think the other people that are not working remotely and come into the office, they have a lot more capability to, you know, multitask, which is something that previously technology did not allow us to do.
Right.
And the other thing is, I think a lot of these people who are coming out of college that are millennials, their experience is a lot more. And they've experienced a lot more of the world at a younger age than maybe a millennial 20 years ago.
Well, it's accessible. Right? It's in front of us all the time.
Exactly. And so access to information doesn't mean that someone is working less hard. And that's something that I want to tell people and the viewers on your show is that it's really important for any recruiter or anyone who's hiring people or hiring millennials that look at a millennial that you're hiring for their skill set and for the way in which they can communicate what their growth trajectory is going to be. Mm-hmm. And if you have someone you want to hire, but it's going to be a remote hire, just make sure that you have the system set up to manage the remote hire.
Right.
Because if you don't have that system set up, then you will find 9-to-3 to be slacking. You will find all of that to be not. But if you have the system set up, the KPIs set up, the training set up, none of that actually matters. What matters is delivery. And delivery has to come in a structured manner. That I'm very clear about.
It becomes on the leader to really set those metrics and to over communicate. And one part of it I think that millennials expect and deservedly is they want to be tied to the outcome and not necessarily financially, although in some cases that's right. But they want to know what their contribution is and who would begrudge someone of that? You don't want to feel like you're just some sort of widget in the process. You want to know. And to me, that's always been sort of, wouldn't everyone want to do that? But not every leader takes the time to really engage and involve them at that level where they truly, no matter what their experience and level is, that they feel tied to the outcomes.
Yeah, I think 20 years ago, the employee was role focused. Mm-hmm. Today, the millennial employee is vision focused.
Right.
So they want to be part of the growth story. They want to be part of the responsibility you give them that aids the growth story. Mm-hmm. And so I think today's managers, today's leaders, including myself, we need to focus on, are we bringing this colleague in and do they feel that, you know, intensity, that motivation, that commitment to the vision? Do they feel pride in the work they're doing? Are their financial packages aligned with the vision of the company or the growth of the company? Mm-hmm. So if all those things align, then you have a great performing millennial employee. Because as you rightly said, if someone gets recognition after having taken that responsibility, mm-hmm. that's what I care about. And I'm also a millennial. And I know I care about that. Because I know I love the feeling when a parent tells me, that was a great first golf camp.
Yeah.
That makes me happiest. And like, whatever price they paid, however much discount I gave, whatever, it doesn't matter at that point. Because what the outcome they received was my moment of pride.
Right. Oh, that's a great line. My moment of pride. What's your moment of pride? And then it's on the leader to make sure that their employees feel that same way.
Absolutely.
Yeah, I think you need to inspire. And some of that is that's another thing that millennials get hit with. They need to be coddled. They need to be overly praised. And I don't think that's the case. I think people want to know when they're doing a good job. They want to know how they can be doing a better job. And it is that ongoing feedback. And that's the fine art of leadership, of knowing, you know, when are you crushing someone's soul and spirit? And when are you giving them feedback to help them grow? And that's the art and science of leadership, really being able to find that delicate balance.
And you're absolutely right. I think the coddling aspect is because leaders tend to have less training. They give less training. Mm-hmm. And sometimes there's a misfit in the position that they've hired that person.
Right.
And then you have to coddle because that person isn't taking initiative or isn't taking their own pride in the work that they're doing. And so I think coddling is a direct reflection on the leader mm-hmm. and not necessarily on the millennial, if you want to call them that.
Right. And of course, there's a big difference between coaching and coddling. And again, it's just finding that line.
Yeah.
And I think that that's been so overblown. I keep thinking there's got to be another word for millennials because it's almost become a bad word and it's so unfair.
Yeah. I mean, the millennial term is quite, I guess, it's overused now. It's used in a way that kind of, oh, that person's a millennial. It means that person is not hardworking. That person is not doing XYZ things. And so one thing I will say, though, about the coddling is that it's okay to tell someone that they're not doing something right or they need to change their approach. And giving feedback is also a very important aspect of the training we provide our managers. Mm-hmm. Because the way in which you give feedback is actually very important. One of the biggest CEOs in Singapore in banking actually told me that giving feedback is like a feedback sandwich. So you always tell them something good they're doing. Then you give them the piece of improvement advice, and then you follow it up by something good they're doing. So the meat is the thing that they need to work on, and the burger buns are the great things that they're already doing.
Right.
And so I've started to use the feedback sandwich, and I tell you, it really helps employees because they leave the meetings with you feeling good about the fact that they need to work on stuff.
Yeah, as long as you are very clear on the burger part, and you don't, because if you sugarcoat it, people don't hear the constructive part of it. But when you're very clear about what can change, I also find that timely feedback is critical.
I'll coach
people who will sit on something. I mean, in one case, it was 2 years. They were upset with an employee and it had gone on forever. And I thought, how could you not have told this person? And by then, the relationships were so soured, it wasn't salvageable. And had it been dealt with at the time, it probably would have blown over and been fine.
Yeah, and I think feedback absolutely is so important and the time of it is so important. Mm-hmm. Most entrepreneurs, they tend to wait a long time to give feedback. in order so that they don't scare off their employee. Or, but you have to come in as soon during training, you have to tell an employee transparently, you're going to receive feedback. It does not mean that the feedback is going to jeopardize your career at our company. Negative feedback does not mean your career is over here. And if you as an employee cannot take negative feedback, then you're probably not a right fit for this company.
Right.
Because constructive feedback is the most important thing for personal development. Mm-hmm. And if somebody cannot notice that they have some blind spots, like I'm telling you right now, my blind spots, right? Mm-hmm. That is a very vulnerable thing to accept. If somebody cannot notice that, accept it, and do something about it, they are not somebody who's in line with your company's vision.
Right. And to be able to share it with others so they can help you shore up your deficits. Exactly. I heard a great description of this from he was the then CEO of Campbell's Soup. And he said the way he looked at it, it was tough on standards and tender toward people. And I thought that was a beautiful way to sum it up.
Beautiful.
The standards are high, but these are people that you're working with and you treat them humanely and kindly. I always think of it as candor and kindness.
Exactly. And, you know, at the end of the day, these are valuable people for your company. You want to make sure that they have the best experience possible. And they're also sales agents for your company if they decide to leave. While when they are in your company, they're definitely advocating your brand, partially because they're obligated to, and the other reason because they believe in the vision. But once they leave the company, and even if someone is fired from your company, the way the firing takes place, if they're still a sales agent for your company in the future, you have a winning employee. I think my biggest moment of happiness from a hiring perspective was this year when an employee, a disgruntled employee, left after 1.5 years with my company. And 6 months later, she came back.
Wow.
And for me, it meant that I actually have the ability to maintain good relationships with current and former employees. And that person actually came back because she realized that this is actually a better place for her to work at than where she was going to.
Yeah.
And so that was a big moment for me as well.
Yeah, that's great. And obviously you navigated that difficult situation well, whether she did or not, but clearly that would have been difficult on both sides, but did it so that she felt like the opportunity arises. And sometimes people don't know how good they have it. I used to joke in my entertainment days that I didn't really want to hire people right out of school because I was a good corporate leader. And I felt like, go get beat up for a year or two and then come in and you'll see what it's like to have that kind of communication and leadership and vision, all of that. So clearly that's what you're doing.
Yeah. And you know, what I'm saying to you guys now is really going to resonate with a lot of other entrepreneurs who are younger, because these are some of the common challenges millennials face, millennial entrepreneurs, which is people you're hiring are the same age as you, if not probably older.
Yeah.
How do you convince them to believe in you, to think of you as astute, as someone who's capable, as someone who's willing to give it their all to help that person make a livelihood and somebody else grow from a personal development standpoint? Another moment that really makes me proud is that 42 people have a livelihood because of me.
Wow.
Right? In this company, we have 13. In the previous company, we have 29. 42 people are making a livelihood because of me. And that's, you know, you see other companies and other CEOs and you go, oh, my friend works at Credit Suisse, or my friend works at Goldman Sachs, and oh, the CEO is paying their salaries. That's me finally.
Yeah.
And that's really, it's exciting. I don't know.
Well, you've got people's livelihoods, in your hands. It's a real stewardship of their careers and their lives and their relationships and all of that, their finances, all of those things. So let me ask you one final question.
Absolutely.
The radical idea. So if you could just say, I want to change the world in some way, what is your radical idea for change and transformation?
I think when I started out on this mission, Libby, I was focused on really helping the best athletes in the world. In Asia, a lot of the best athletes are from villages, are from provincial towns. They're from areas of where they don't have the meets. So one of my biggest radical ideas is to allocate some of our events where the participants are identified from villages, from smaller towns in Southeast Asia, places where they have no exposure and no ability to get to US colleges, places where they have no ability to have multi-sport experiences. And using our referral program, our ambassador program that we mentioned earlier, mm-hmm. we can reach those kids. And even the people who are referring us those kids feel it's a very noble cause, because we are reaching a kid that, you know, their dad is a milkman, or their dad is a servant to a family in the Philippines, or is, you know, cleaning toilets, whatever it is. That's their poverty-stricken cycle. If I can use sport to get them out of that, give them a tool for education, then we are making a radical change. One thing is to be commercially profitable, to have a great camps business, but the other is to actually help the best athletes. And there is a correlation between limited affluence and athletic ability in Southeast Asia. And we are trying to promote the grassroots athletes to become the next wave of college-bound student athletes. And if they decide to become professional in the future, that is their own prerogative. But my focus is using that tool to get them a great education and get them out of that poverty-stricken cycle.
That's great. You can change that. And as they pay it forward, that transforms lives.
Absolutely.
So Akshay Maliwal, where do we learn more about you and Dream Big Events?
Absolutely. So please look at our website, DreamBig.Events, and please follow me on LinkedIn, Akshay Maliwal. And if you ever want more information, there's always live Instagram, Instagram stories, DreamBigEvents.Asia. That's our Instagram handle. Follow me across these platforms, and there's so many more updates, and there's so many more exciting things for Dream Big Events. The goal for us is to connect 1 million student athletes to different camp experiences in the next 20 years.
Wow.
Let's make that a reality. Dream big.
I think you're well on your way, and I'll share all those platforms in our show notes. And thank you so much for being here. It was really inspiring.
Thank you. Namaste.
Namaste.
Thanks for listening to this episode of The Radical CEO. We invite you to view the episode blog post at our website, libbygill.com/podcast, to get links and access additional resources. Join us again next time for another episode of The Radical CEO.